Rise and Shine Rwanda.
Good morning. You're watching Rise and Shine Rwanda with me, Ivan Magwene.
And me, Peace Kwizera, coming up on Rise and Shine.
In our story of the day, we bring you a close-up of the 2016 Rio Olympics.
And in business, we take a look at the ongoing expo in Kigali.
In lifestyle, today it's Thursday's movie review and cult classic. Well, all that and more still to come, but first we get to meet the rest of the team. Good morning, Stefan.
Good morning, Ivan.
How are you doing today?
I'm all right.
You're ready for the show?
Yeah, sure, I am.
Good morning, Chantal.
Good morning.
And good morning, Peace.
Good morning.
I bet you aren't ready for that one.
I was not.
All right, so we're bringing you all the latest stories, making headlines in Rwanda and across the world shortly. Starting off with the local stories. Now, the Rwandan Prime Minister has said Rwanda is on course to achieve universal access to water by the end of next year, and the government will make heavy investments in water processing and supply within the next few months to achieve that target. Now, the government says it wants to increase households' access to clean water countrywide from 74.2% in 2010 to 100% in 2017. While the fourth Integrated Household Living Conditions Survey published in September last year indicated that 84.8% of Rwandans access potable water, the Premier said that the remaining steps towards universal access will be realized by the end of next year. As we're talking about stories of shortage of water, especially during this dry season, here we have the Prime Minister talking about having universal clean water to every Rwandan by 100% by next year, which I think is a very good plan. Mm-hmm. But in this case, Peace, do you think it's quite ambitious, which ambition is not bad, but sometimes do you actually think this is realizable, as he says in his words?
Yeah, of course it is. I mean, it's next year, and we talk about ambition already. If you already set goals and hope to achieve them, that's, you know, being ambitious enough. And I think this is a good move.
Do we actually see that coming, looking at the fact that at least rural part Rwanda still suffers with the shortage of water? Making a plan like this one and having this in numbers, do we actually think that this is the real truth on the ground, that people now have 84.8% of Rwandan households do have access to clean water? Do you think it's actually true?
Well, okay, it's an ambitious goal, but okay, there is this Nzovu project that was completed, and it here just in Kigali, and some neighborhoods really the water supply improved, but we still have the challenge in here. Some neighborhoods, some suburbs are not connected, so but now this is the whole country at large, so I think maybe. Every region, because when you go to Bujesera, it's different from, let's say, somewhere in Musanze. Maybe every region needs a unique solution to get the water. But as for whether all 85% of households can have water next year, well, it's good to work towards it and see what it's like. But let's not just question everything. Yeah, let's just stick to
the plan.
Yes. I think Rwanda is just full of, you know, surprises. I believe by the time they say that is going to happen by 2017, they have plans for rural areas.
They do, but I don't think it would be 100% accomplished.
That's just you say so, yes. I think
anyway, that's true.
Now, one of the five Rwandans, Tina, who were chosen to represent Rwanda in Top Model Africa in Zimbabwe, who was denied a chance for her ticket being paid for and found a way to pay her own ticket herself, and went, of course, ahead and competed and ended up coming up with a trophy that she went looking for. And, of course, this trophy was worth over, you know, $1,500, and which is really good. But I'm not talking about this topic so that, you know, we see that there is a girl who went and competed. This is usually like normal things, but I'm just talking it in a level of, we see so many people denied chances to do something and then they be great, you know, at the end of it when they hustle their, I would use the word hustle their way to find other things. What would you say be on something like the, on being denied a chance, I mean?
Yeah. Number one is that as I was actually watching a video before this where Bruno Mars talks about his encounter in Hollywood, the fact that even people never gave him a chance because of his... just the way where he was from. I mean, he's not he's kind of had another race. Mm. You don't just give up like that. I mean, she has, you know, sometimes I think right now, even her success there is worth, she feels more, like it's more enjoying because it is almost a message you're sending out to people, but most important, it is coming something that I think is very hard. So it is simple. It's almost, I don't want to use that cliche word that, you know, never give up or what, but it is what it is. And I think just never giving up on your dreams is one important thing. She went there, she shined, and now she's in the papers.
And the country is taking the credit as well.
I know, that's the world. People want to associate with success, but they don't want to work towards success.
Or they don't even want to be a part of, you know, just growing into that success. And
sure, I mean, that spirit that makes you have that confidence that I'm going to go this and I'm sure I'll come back with something. That's a good spirit. I mean, maybe should inspire other girls in the fashion industry, because there's a fashion industry in the country, and it's growing. So this maybe can show that it can change the perception about fashion, because it's not all about modeling.
People mostly think that with fashion you're wasting resources, you're wasting money. So thinking of giving you the funds to go out there, they don't know how much it means because they haven't seen much from the fashion industry. So I think people should give a shot and a chance to such people so that they go there and shine.
Yes,
now, moving on to the other story, Donald Trump has dismissed Barack Obama's time in the White House as, I quote, a disaster, after the U.S. president said he was not fit to succeed him. But before we go any further, here's an interview Donald Trump had with the ABC anchor.
Well, he's a terrible president. He'll probably go down as the worst president in the history of our country. He's been a total disaster. You look at what's happened to the Middle East. You look at what's happened with Syria and his line in the sand. I think it just means he's concerned that I'm going to win. Don't forget, he said last time I would never get the nomination. Now he's saying I wouldn't get the election. Now all of a sudden he said the other day, well, maybe I can win the election. No, I guess he probably has to say that kind of a thing.
Well, there you have Donald Trump saying Barack Obama's, term in office has been a total disaster. He has put the country at the worst. He has put it in different conflicts. Let's talk about healthcare and everything. The economy is doing. I mean, this is Donald Trump saying all the things after all the controversy. And of course, this was the message by Barack Obama after Donald Trump attacked the family of Khan, who spoke at the Democratic National Convention, attacking his family and also not forgetting that they do have a son that died in the war. But anyways, we've talked about lots of controversies around Donald Trump. But is he in the right position to question Obama's term in office, Stephen?
I think Obama. Obama has been president for this long, and his track record is there for out for everybody to see,
to comment on.
So I would imagine, I expect somebody like Trump to pick out some points to make.
After all, it's Trump. If he hadn't said anything about that, after all he has said, what would you expect?
Yeah. But
I mean, you know, he has even no right to say that, you know, about Barack Obama. If his wife could go ahead and copy the wife's speech, clearly, that's just, you know, I'm just saying, I think I'm just, you know, over the whole Donald Trump story, or saga, or what it is. But I just, I think, you know, he has no right to be questioning Barack Obama's, you know, work. Because, you know, by the time you go on to replace someone, you have to pick out a few things to learn from them. Yeah. Not just questioning and being judgmental and, you know, being so opinionated about things. So that's just, you know, my say.
Okay, maybe you can look at Obama's track record.
Absolutely. He is Obama, a guy that inherited the world crisis. I mean, he came into presidency when America was doing so bad. He has restored some of the most difficult relationships with Cuba, with Iran, has signed a deal with Iran. He has tried to control the situation for ISIS right now. Things are not that bad. Looking at, he has created more jobs in his his office. I don't know where we need to, you know.
I just can't wait for a movie about Donald Trump. I know it's coming up.
All right, okay.
For sure. Now, a Kenyan man, of course, was accused of chopping his wife's hands and hacking her to death
with a machete after blaming her on their childless marriage should focus face the full force of the law, rights activists have said. Now, I'm not going to go into so much detail. This is Kenya, and this is violence, you know, against women. And I don't know why I usually talk about this so much. Mm-hmm. But when I find stories like this in the news, I feel like, you know, there is, we need to do more awareness, because like you're saying, you know, a few days on the show, mm-hmm. you know, we count, you know, our words kind of count. So this mm-hmm. is, I believe this is the time that, you know, we share that whoever is being, you know, having problems in their marital homes or, you know, being mistreated, at least, you know, hears from the rest of us. I just want to hear your views on this. What kind of person does that because the wife can't have kids? Just Stephen, tell me your view.
Well, I think this particular guy was maybe mad. Okay, we have violence against women. Mm-hmm. And, okay, it's general, his wife battering and all those sorts of things, but this goes beyond. I mean, you can't put this case in that, mm-hmm. those other mm-hmm. cases. But I've seen such cases before where, maybe a man kills the wife or, injures seriously. But then before that, you hear the man was like this, he was stalking the woman. A lot of things. So I like maybe some type of system set up to track such violent fellows, because you see this is what happens. If this is what is going to happen in the end, I know there are such cases out there.
That need help. That's what happens. I mean, when you look at the few pictures, of course, of the mm-hmm. woman, you see hands that are off. You see a face that is messed up. I mean, mm-hmm. she's cut up. Like she has not only lost a husband or even just her arms, but she has lost even, I would say, all the confidence. And that's just, you know, very mean of someone to just go ahead and do that. I'm just, let's move on, of course, to the next story.
I'm moving on to another story. We are to the rainbow nation, South Africa. Now, South Africans are voting local elections, putting ANC at test. Now, the ANC has dominated the political landscape since the first all-race elections in 1994. But Mr. Zuma has had to weigh the scandal after being ordered to repay taxpayers' money spent on his private homes. Now, polls show that the ANC may lose control of three key cities, Pretoria, Johannesburg, and Port Elizabeth. Now, some senior ANC officials have said that Mr. Zuma should stand down because of the scandals and the country's weak economy. Analysts also have called on, saying that one would also increase the popularity also of ANC is also decreasing by the day, making, you know, ANC a little bit less popular since 1994 when Nelson Mandela became president. But here's the main challenge. Is actually the ANC's control of now, because Johannesburg, Pretoria, and Port Elizabeth are very key cities in South Africa. I would say very prime. And losing such kind of key cities as a party, does that sound anything for Jacob Zuma's ANC, Shanta?
Looking at the fact that South Africans haven't been so happy with Jacob Zuma and his leadership, and this is why most of them are withdrawing from the ANC. But we should note that it still has supporters, however much the key cities are not supporting it. So I think there might be a change. Maybe the DA, the Democratic Assembly, is coming up, or the EFF, who knows?
Yes, Stephen.
If ANC were to lose in any of these towns, it would be really, it would be a significant blow to their campaign. But the ANC has lots of supporters in the rural areas. That's where you have the majority of the people. But then again, when you look at Julius Malema's party,
The EFF,
Front, it's for it targets maybe it's more for the black South Africans. And then there's the Democratic Assembly. For it, I think it's for the corporates. I mean,
Democratic Alliance.
And they are, the Democratic Alliance is also growing. So they will need to put reach to the masses, maybe to the rural areas.
And
but the ANC has lost some people because of, okay, maybe over the years they haven't been getting some things right. Yeah. Mm. But it should make for an interesting election.
All right, we'll hold it from there. And of course, more of these stories go onto our YouTube page, Rise and Shine Rwanda, and be able to follow all these stories. We'll be back shortly with the story of the day. Welcome back to Rise and Shine Rwanda's story of the day. Now, the countdown is coming to an end as the beautiful Rio de Janeiro hosts the Summer Olympics. Already, there has been controversial stories about the first ever Olympics in South America. Now, before the games kick off, we give you a deep analysis of the 2016 Rio Olympics. But before we go any further and get into the mood, here's a little bit of a package we compiled for you. Rio, Rio now, people. It's almost a few hours from now that we're going to be having the Rio Olympics. But of course, we have been talking about it. But I would say that is actually the first question I would ask, Stephen. Mm. Do you think there has been at least enough, a little bit of positive coverage of the Rio Olympics before the event start compared to the other previous Olympics in London and Beijing?
There's been a lot of maybe more focus on the negatives than the positives, because there's the proposed blanket ban on Russian athletes. Mm-hmm. Then before that there was the Zika virus, and then there's been complaints about the facilities, the hotels not being ready, and then there's the talk of the water not being clean enough for the rowers, and well, there's been a lot, but. I don't know if but it depends on what you want to focus on. Mm-hmm. Okay, I follow the rugby, so this is the Olympics where we're going to have the rugby sevens. Mm-hmm. So all these guys who perform for their countries in the World Cup, they're going to be there.
Yeah.
And then when you go to tennis, you'll have the Djokovic's, those star players.
Yeah.
And go to soccer, you'll have the Neymars. Mm-hmm. So focusing when we ignore the rest.
Mm-hmm.
Our stars are going to be there. Then we also have the Rwandans. Salmi Nyarukundo, we're talking about.
Yeah.
Okay, where are you pointing? Anyways, I'm so proud that Rwandans had to be out there and represent the country.
But anyways, peace. What are some of the games you're looking forward to, especially looking at the fact that, I don't know, somehow, somewhere, one time I was having a discussion and you told me one day I had a dream to be the Olympics. Yes. I don't know for which game, but...
Badminton? Yes.
Badminton.
Yes, actually, I look forward to watching, mainly the
tennis, the kind of the racket games, because I'm more of that. Back in the day when I was young and I had a lot of dreams and a future, I hoped to go to the 2016 Olympics in Rio. And now look, I'm here reporting about it. Dreams do change, but I mean, it's okay. But of course, I'm looking forward to also seeing, you know, Usain Bolt break another record.
Oh, yeah, Usain Bolt.
Yes,
yeah.
I can't wait for Usain Bolt to break another record. Mm-hmm. He's faster than Wi-Fi, I would say, everywhere. That's according to
the registered Wi-Fi.
Yes, of course. And, you know, I'm looking forward to a variety of games. I'm looking forward to, you know, the racket games. I'm looking forward to... With Olympics, you know, it's just countries that you're supporting. It doesn't necessarily mean that it's just any other, you know, game. It's just seeing the best of every country go out there to represent. You know, sometimes you just watch... maybe even with long distance running, you see them run and you're like, okay, there are people they do like rounds on, you know, like
and plus the Sudanese who went there.
The refugee team.
And the refugee team, you know, there is just so much to look forward to in the this year's Rio Olympics, and of course we'll be out supporting our very own, the Saramanyeru Kundos and the Sudanese, and because they're East Africans.
Saying,
And if it goes on and East Africans, which is not going to be the case, East Africans are going to bring gold medals.
Yeah.
But if they don't do that, we'll just stick to being Africans. So that's just what I'm saying.
I'd love to ask both of you, if you put down your predictions, who do you think are some of the countries that are going to come up with more medals than the others? Looking at...
Well, me, I think Russia has always done well.
Yeah. But this time they
the
also
Kenyans.
Face...
Yeah, and the Kenyans.
Yeah. Kenyans really
I would say in Africa, I think...
The Jamaicans,
for me,
those guys
long distance really running, I think Kenyans will do pretty well. I would also say in China and Malaysia, in badminton, tennis games, they'll do pretty, you know, pretty well.
And acrobatics.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, and of course, Jamaica.
in athletics.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm just looking forward to these different things. And I hope... You know, people.
Yes. Well, I'm looking forward to what the running athletes are going to do. Because we also have have two in swimming. We have road racing and cycling, cross country. We have in athletics too, long distance. So these are they're all qualified there, and more than. Medals aside, I would like to see these people really improving on their individual performance, maybe breaking national records.
Is Ricky Pratish going back? I'm so proud of him.
Anyways, for viewers, be sure, of course, to catch the beautiful opening moment as, of course, Rio hosts the 2016 Olympics. Let's all remember that the Olympics are a time to unite the world and also bring out the competition, but most important of all, be able to, you know, share and also be able to learn from these same Olympics. You've been watching Rise and Shine, Rwanda Story of the Day. Shantaro Wera will be up next with business.
Here is to traveling and saving. Starting 1st of April to the 1st of June, travel with Rwandair and take advantage of our reduced fares and enjoy our world-class services in great comfort and safety.
Fly our dream to the heart of Africa.
Welcome back. It's now time for your business stories with me, Chantal Wera. The government has condemned Burundi's recent decision to ban exports destined for Rwanda, saying it was a serious breach of the EAC trade agreements, but said it will have no impact on the Rwandan economy. Addressing a news conference on regional and international trade, the Minister of Trade and Industry, Francois Kanimba, stated that the decision would not in any way affect Rwanda's economy. More than 200 local and international exhibitors are expected to participate in this month's Mombasa International Agriculture Show. At least 120 exhibitors have confirmed their participation in the fair that will take place at the Mkomani grounds from August 24th to 28th, where China, India, Russia, Pakistan, Tanzania and Uganda are expected to participate in the fair.
And still in Kenya, since the introduction of the taxi hailing company in Kenya, Uber, a lot of drivers signed to it, while other traditional taxi drivers protested against the company, largely blamed worldwide for killing other taxi businesses. A drastic change was made to contract without consulting the partners, which is going to impact negatively to other businesses. The union head of the protesting drivers, Emmanuel Kasina, told local media that they were not able to make a return on their investments. Well, that's all we had for you today in business. Kalimba Steven will be up next with sports.
Welcome back. Time now for your sports news with me, Steven Kalimba. Starting with tennis, the 2016 Rwanda Open Tennis Championship has been moved to September 25th at the Amahoro Stadium courts. The event, which was initially scheduled for August 22nd, will attract tennis stars from all regional countries. The development was confirmed by the Rwanda Tennis Federation President, Kasim Ntageruka, who also promised the best level of tournament, including top tennis players from the regional countries. Currently, Rwanda is suspended from participating in any international Tennis Federation activities or competitions after failure to pay the annual membership fee. And in rugby, the Rwanda National Rugby League is set to kick off again this Saturday. The league was halted in Epo, and in a new fixtures, reigning champions who are third on the Kigali League, Remera Buffaloes, will take on Lyon Dauphin Rugby Club. The Buffaloes have put aside their quarrel with the Rwanda Rugby Federation after some controversial decisions against them in the league and June's National Memorial Tournament Sevens. Thousand Hills lead the Kigali League with 13 points, while in the Southern League, Resilience lead with 24 points. And in the Olympics, the International Olympic Committee President Thomas Bach has said the way sports deal with drug cheats need fundamental reform. We need a full review of the WADA anti-doping system, said Bach. He said the uncovering of widespread Russian doping had shown up deficiencies in the world, in the WADA. Mr. Bach's condemnation of WADA escalates a feud between the Olympics and anti-doping bodies, which broke out in the run-up to Rio. He, however, said a blanket ban of all Russian athletes would cause death and devastation, and that allowing some athletes was a positive for clean athletes. And there you had it. Peace Quizera is up next with Lifestyle.
Here is to traveling and saving. Starting 1st of April to the 1st of June, travel with Randair and take advantage of our reduced fares and enjoy our world-class services in great comfort and safety.
Fly our dream to the heart of Africa.
Welcome back to Rise and Shine. It's time for Lifestyle with me, Peace Quizera. Now, for movie review today, from visionary director Tim Burton and based upon the best-selling novel, comes an unforgettable motion picture experience when Jack discovers clues from a mystery that spans different worlds at a time. He finds a magical place known as Miss Peregrine's Home of Follicular Children, but the mystery and danger deepen as he gets into the residence and learns about their special powers and their powerful enemies. Ultimately, Jack discovers that his only own special peculiarity is to save the new friends. Take a look at the trailer.
Come with me. There's a place I go when I want to be alone.
There's a new world coming. And it's just around the bend. There's a new This one's coming to an end.
How did you?
Air. It's my peculiarity. If I show you the rest, you have to promise not to run away.
Right on time.
Miss Peregrine, delighted to meet you.
He's invisible.
Of course. We're what's known in common parlance as peculiar.
Claire, why aren't you eating?
She's embarrassed in front of Jake.
Don't be.
Because our abilities don't fit in the outside world, we live in places like this, where no one can find us.
Jake, come and play!
I knew you were one of us when you were born. It's time for you to learn what you can do.
But I'm just ordinary.
No, you're not. You were born to protect us.
Promise me one thing. Look after them, Jake.
I promise.
There's a new world coming.
And for cult classic today, we look at the classic movie called Love and Basketball. Love and Basketball is about how you can either be in love or play basketball, but it's tricky to do both at the same time. It may be unique among sports movies in that it does not end with the big game. Instead, it's a thoughtful and touching story about two affluent black kids, a boy and a girl, who grew up loving each other and the game. Let's take a look at the trailer.
Can I play? All right, you and Kelvin against me and Jamal.
Oh, man,
he's a girl.
Hey, girls can't play no ball.
Ball better than you.
I'm going to be the first girl in the NBA.
No, I'm going to be in the NBA. You're going to be my cheerleader.
They play the same game.
If you don't start a bad attitude,
30 for 5.
No one's going to recruit you.
I'm a ball player.
With a jacked up attitude.
They share the same dream.
You'd love for him to play USC like you did, right?
No, I'd love for him to get a good education.
I don't know why I keep hoping you'll grow out of this tomboy thing.
I won't. I'm a lesbian.
That's not funny.
Damn. You don't look half bad.
You either.
How about a little one-on-one?
What we playing for?
I score, you strip. Take it off. Take it off.
Strip.
All's fair in love and basketball, baby.
There's only one way to be successful at anything, and that is to give everything.
Coach has us on 11 o'clock curfew. I can stay a few more minutes.
I'm sweating.
I'm sorry. I don't have it easy like you, all right? There's no red carpet laid out for me.
And ain't no way some soft freshman is taking my spot.
Monica, hustle up, move it!
You forgot to be there.
If I stayed, I wouldn't be starting.
Well, at least you got your priorities straight. Look, I'm entering a draft. I'm going pro.
So that's it. Just forget about you and me.
New Line Cinema presents a story about the passion it takes.
I never knew anyone love ball as much as you.
To keep your dreams alive.
I've loved you since I was 11, and it just won't go away.
This spring.
I'll play you. One game, one-on-one.
For what?
Your heart.
All's fair in love and basketball.
All right, there you had it. But before we go any further, I want to hear from the team. It's a cult classic. It's that time where we talk about the movie. Steven, I'm going to start this off with you. It's love and basketball. You know, you are a sports guy, and then, you know, we know.
You're
little
human.
Bit of,
you're you human. Fall in love.
You could fall in love with a game. Mm-hmm. How would you relate to this game? You know, just you as a person.
Well, I haven't fallen in love with a basketball chick before. But I like this movie. Okay, it's been a while since I watched it. But Omar Epps, that's a guy who's really been in the black American movies. He's really stood out. And when you look at Shanna Lathan,
yes.
This is a girl, she's an actress who you'll put in any scene and she'll just...
be great at
Yeah, be great. Because I followed her. Okay, recently she was in The Perfect Gentleman. But she's been, as long as you put her in a movie, it has really come out. So, yeah, these two guys, they make a good combination and...
Yes. Now I'm moving this on to Ivan. Ivan, you usually have the statistics for us. I just want you to briefly tell us what this movie would have, you know, came out. Okay, of course it came out in 2000, and you know it's been a while. But we need to hear at least how much maybe it made, or how many people are, you know, viewing or watching the movie, or excited about, you know, the whole experience.
Love and basketball. Yeah. Quite a very great movie. One of the things is it was at least ranked among the 10 best 2000 black movies. I think it was also rewarded for one of the black, I don't know, some award. I think during the BET something was awarded to the movie. But most importantly about the movie was, I don't know a lot about how much it made on the box office. But one thing is I know it was one of the best 2000s black movies to watch. Quite a very interesting story, I would say, especially looking at the game of b-ball, because it's a game that requires a lot of work, but at the same time looking at this story that started away when people were still 11 years old, it is a very good story to watch. Especially I think this is a movie that was at least watched by very many young people.
Yes.
Looking at what kind of genre it kind of...
High school hit.
Yeah, high school hit. Absolutely.
The fact that most people relate to it, something about black American movies.
Yeah, black kind of movies. And it's love and basketball. People should go back and watch it because it shows love, trust, but most important also when it gets to like with work and the hard work involved
and something
in
you
basketball.
Love,
pro yeah. sports.
Now, I would say, you know, this movie was kind of a different experience for me from I think what you guys are saying.
When did
I
you mean, watch it, by the way? Sometimes we even
a
forget.
A while back, like I think 2 to 3 years ago. Anyway, okay. So just to wrap up this movie was just more of just an experience for me. It gives you destiny, you know, because they're destined to be together. It gives you hope. It gives you hard work because she had to go all the way, you know, to wherever that she went and studied there and came back and found him engaged. You know, it was just, it gives you those hard moments and those good moments, which is why I think all of you should go back in time and watch that movie. It's Love and Basketball.
Do you know how you sound right now?
What?
Very romantic. Because it's all about destiny and everything.
She said going back in time.
Absolutely.
Going back in time. Anyway, that is all we had for you for today's show. But don't forget, we love to hear thoughts, comments, and feedback on what you're talking about here on Rise and Shine Rwanda. Mm-hmm. Tweet us at Rise and Shine RW. Like us on our Facebook page and do send us your ideas for the program. Check out our Rise and Shine YouTube page and please subscribe. That's where you can catch all the shows and the reports that we do. Find us on Instagram and remember, we love to see your pics. Last but not least, check out our website and also endeavor to follow us on Snapchat. I am Peace Quizera.
And I'm Ivan Magwene Ubia. Sometimes, same place, tomorrow, do join us then. But for now, it's goodbye.
Bye-bye.